Hello and welcome to Amazing Mind, the HMI web TV talk show that introduces you to all sorts of interesting people and topics related to the subconscious mind. My name is Lisa Mackenberg, hypnotherapist, HMI instructor, and host. Today we have an amazing guest who's going to talk to us about the near-death experience. It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Brian Nye, my husband, who is going to be talking to us about people who have died and lived to tell about it. Please help me welcome Dr. Brian Nye. Thank you. Well, Brian, when we were courting and right after we got married, you shared with me so many experiences of from other physicians and from yourself about patients who had had near-death experiences. And then based on that, you started to research it. Can you share with us some of the things that you heard from your patients and from other medical professionals?
Yes, I got interested in this because I had a patient who had a number of serious illnesses, and I saw her as an adult, and I asked her at one point how it was that she was able to still transcend this, because she seemed like a very serene individual. And she told me that as a very young child, probably before she had language, she had an experience where she was having surgery for an infection, and she had a near-death experience where she was transported to an area where it was an area of light, mm-hmm. and she was comforted. She was in kind of a cradle-like environment and comforted by a choir of very soothing music. And the details of it, are not the important part to me, but the issue, the idea that from this experience, she came away and was never afraid of death again.
Wow.
And it got her through a lot of very difficult personal things and medical problems.
So. Any other experiences that were shared with you directly from patients?
I had another patient who had a few months prior to me having seeing him, he had previously had a cardiac arrest, and he also described what many people have described with near-death experiences, and that is an out-of-body experience, and then going to an area, again, an area of light, mm-hmm. and also, but being told that it wasn't his time, mm. you know, and that he had to come back. But it was, again, an extremely comforting experience for him. He had a sense of overwhelming joy in this place that he was taken to, and a reluctance to come back,
sure.
as many people have had with these. So.
But if you've talked to other medical professionals, not everybody's near-death or post-death experience is positive.
A tiny number of these are negative. The overwhelming majority are positive experiences. But one was described to me that when I was in training, some residents were resuscitating an individual who came in and out of a coma essentially multiple times, and apparently told them that he was in a hellish environment between times when they were able to talk to him. So that, and you can read about a few other negative ones, but the overwhelming majority of these are positive experiences.
Well, that'll change it.
Yeah.
So what do physicians who are also scientists, what do they make of the near-death phenomenon?
The Raymond Moody was the real pioneer in this field. I think everybody agrees. He wrote a book in 1975 called Life After Life. And what he did, he doesn't use the term syndrome, but I would term what he did similar to what we do in medicine in general. I mean, everybody comes to this question. Most people have heard about what I have just described, and people bring to this their own religious background, and they say, does this confirm my religious background, or is this discordant in some way? So what Raymond Moody did is he did what physicians do in that circumstance. They try to put it all together, and he created a syndrome of what he called 9 different things that seemed common in near-death experiences.
What are those 9 things?
And other people have come up with similar numbers, but there's an out-of-body experience,
mm-hmm.
and then there's this indescribable joy that people have. There's a tunnel experience, and being taken to an area of light towards the heavens, essentially, and then meeting relatives who have passed previously, And then if there's a, this is kind of stepwise, if you keep going further into the experience, some people will then have a an experience with a being of light that's often described as. And then lastly, being told that it's not their time, there's a barrier, or and then a reluctance to coming back, because again, it's such a an overwhelmingly positive experience.
And that being of light is interpreted as a different person, depending on one person's belief or culture.
There seems to be that too, yes. But mostly it's the commonality is what's emphasized. Most people have an experience that's relatively similar.
After Raymond Moody, other physicians built on this work, and there's a doctor named Dr. Long, and he again began to take a look and start to quantify and come up with characteristics that he believed pointed to that this is a real phenomenon versus a dream or hallucination. Can you speak to that?
Dr. Jeffrey Long has looked at this and analyzed it, and by reasoning pointed out some things about this, and that is that this doesn't seem to be like a dream or a hallucination. People's consciousness seems to be very linear, and their description of these things very linear. It's not like a dream where you're in one of these things that I'm describing, and then all of a sudden you're in a car driving down the freeway with a dog in the seat next to you or something like that. It's it's very different. And another thing that he cites is that there are multiple of these where, I'll describe one, an individual who had a near-death experience out of body and sees people trying to resuscitate him, and then the guy in the bed next to him also has a cardiac arrest. So he sees this clamor, the people running, scurrying all over the place, that they don't have enough, and worrying that they don't have enough equipment, and running from bed to bed and, and trying to resuscitate the two individuals. And when he comes back, he's able to describe this to the doctor. The doctor says, you couldn't possibly have known that. You were in a coma, essentially. And so there's some, there's many, many instances like this. Another individual who kind of traveled outside of the area of the resuscitation and saw a shoe on a roof, and this was later corroborated. Or another individual who told the nurse, could you please get my teeth out of where you put them in the drawer during the code, this type of thing.
Wow.
So so that's cited as another thing that makes this not just a dream. And then the commonality is another thing that he cites, that if you look at these descriptions across cultures, across religions, they're very similar. And children have similar experiences even before they have language. These are the things that he cited as proof that this is not just a hallucination.
What were some of the other ones, the sensory ones, forgive me?
Well, there is a, you can have a heightened awareness of heightened hearing, heightened ability to see, to be able to see great distances, and that this would not, the descriptions of the senses are very, again, very different. People describe that they see things, again, if they go into this experience where they're taken up towards the heavens, that the light is a very different characteristic, that it is all the colors possible. It's not just white light. And exactly what they're describing, I can't tell, but they're all describing something very different from any of our experiences, our day-to-day experiences.
Could someone who's under anesthesia experience?
Thanks for reminding me of that. That's one of the other lines of evidence, is that people under anesthesia occasionally have these experiences as well, and their body is heavily anesthetized, would not be able to sense anything, and is having these same exact experiences as the individuals who are
seeing, hearing, feeling, smelling.
Yes.
Which someone couldn't possibly do under anesthesia.
Right.
Was there any evidence that these people were clinically dead? There was no heart rate and no brain waves discernible.
Some of the researchers have looked at try to correlate the times, and yes, this is at a time when there's no cardiac activity.
Can you tell us, is there anything else that Dr. Long has shared with us about lines of evidence?
Let's see. Let me refer to my notes, please.
Please do.
Yes, your memory might be better than mine on some of these
like
things.
An elephant, you know, because you're married to me.
Yes. Yes. That's all that I could come up with.
That's terrific. Well, we're going to be taking a break in a moment, and you have two or three more physicians who've also researched this. Give us a sneak preview of what we're going to talk about in the second segment.
There's a Dr. Melvin Morse who built on Raymond Moody's work, saying, well, these people have often been transformed by their experience, and what is it? How are they changed?
Great.
Afterwards, and it did some good scientific work on that.
Oh, good. So when we come back, we can talk about how people are changed by these experiences, what the commonality of people who have these experiences, how are they different psychologically than people who don't have these experiences, and I'm also going to talk to you about what your personal belief and interpretation is when we come back. So we are going to be taking a short break. But please stay tuned, because when we come back, we're going to talk more about people who have died and lived to tell about it, and also about what physicians, how they interpret the near-death experience. Stay tuned. We'll be right back with Amazing Minds.